my dear, we're still goodbye. But as long as you love me so, let it snow.
You a ho, you a ho.
All them hoes. All them beautiful hoes.
Perfect lyrics. I could have rhymed, you know, like dying. Right? All this good shits, and they're like, you know, dying would have worked right
or,
there.
Or like, and I got some chicken for frying.
Yeah, yeah. So you know, so at least if you ain't gonna be dying, you know, let us bone. That's for the ladies.
Now, see, we really need to start writing this shit down.
Back
in my proper drinking days, which is funny to think. I mean, I don't consider these proper. This is just who I am.
These are my medically induced
days.
That's
true. These are my medically induced days. I like that. I like that a lot. We'd get fucking trashed playing beer pong and shit, because when you're in your 20s, you gotta have competitive reason to drink.
Let's find a way to drink more.
It's got to be a competitive reason to drink.
Yeah, I don't know. I did, but it's because I was in the Marines. Like,
yeah.
So what's your drinking game? I'm going to finish one. I'm going to drink another one.
I kind of don't need a reason. But if I feel like I can beat your ass in a game of skill while I'm getting drunk, that was my mindset at the time. That, and we had a fucking championship belt that was made of foam that I bought from Walmart.
Oh, good, man.
But it was the classic WCW belt. It was old gold.
And that's some shit. I saw one at Walmart, too, for all the hijinks we do around here. It's like, so if I got a real one, which I'd thought about for a while, I was like, it's gonna be about $250.
Yeah.
And second of all, it'd be a real belt, and motherfuckers would actually like be covetous about that. So I could get one for like $10 at Walmart.
Oh yeah, yeah, and fucking, it's still a matter of pride,
to a degree.
But
like,
then,
well, you lost your belt. Yeah, I know, that piece of shit.
Then we're gonna have to think of like what we're gonna do to compete for this fucking thing.
And feats of strength, right?
Every day is gonna, every week's gonna be Festivus.
Get the aluminum pole out, you know.
Tinsel's very distracting.
Mead Metal MMA Podcast is the Christmas edition, so
bit of a rare one.
We hadn't done one in a couple weeks, so I felt we were due. But we're also gonna do one next week because then it's your birth week. And then we're gonna do one a week after that because Brett's in town.
God damn! And then we're done, right? Then we're just gonna stop.
And we're going to do another one about my birthday in April.
There we go. Yeah. See you beautiful bitches in a couple months.
Yeah. Well, I know we'll probably, then we'll do one right before that pay-per-view. When the hell is that going to be?
270?
Yeah. The
Goddamn, we might be back to
22nd, man.
Well, all right, we'll get a week off.
Yeah. Yeah. At that point, then we'll start going back to kind of normal. Now, I say we're going to do one, Brett's in town.
Those of you that know,
about 50-50 on that shit.
Yeah.
That guy gets sounds like, should we do a podcast? No, let's just stand around and drink.
Well, by the time 6 o'clock rolls around, we're talking about other shit and we're already halfway to where we need to be.
We're usually, we're already on that fucking...
Who knows who we're going to piss off, right?
Yeah. I keep going through wondering, like, because I throw some shit out all the time. I never know who's going to respond to it.
Yeah.
I called out somebody last time around, told him to go fuck himself.
Oh, yeah, I remember that guy.
But apparently, it was aggravating enough for him to know that, like, well, this is not my crowd.
He's clearly moved on.
Might be a little bit of rage in this. I'm trying to figure out a way to stifle it, keep that lid on it, keep the good Yuletide feelings going around here and things like that, but... I just got to let you know, some of you piss me off really, really bad. And by you, I don't mean actually you, the casual listener of this particular show. Which, by the way, it's pretty awesome that you're hanging out with us on this Christmas Eve.
Yeah. Happy Chrimbus.
I'm talking about assholes that I call friends.
Ooh. Right? Ooh. Is this about to get real personal between us or what?
No, not you.
Oh, all right. Thank God.
No, there's another one, and those of you that know, you know. Let me ask. Let
ears
me ask
are
this.
Already burning, baby.
Let me ask this.
What's up?
So if you have, if you got a friend,
yeah, I don't have,
any and you're friends. And you're messaging, texting, I don't give a fuck. However you communicate, you know, okay, in the WhatsApp app or whatever, and you have a dialogue. How many messages are acceptable until you're like, what the fuck? Call me.
Huh. You know, that's okay. this might be a very biased answer just because I...
Well, and I've played it out like you're like the normal everyman, and you're not.
No, I'm very anti-messaging.
Yeah.
It's like messaging is not meant to replace conversation. You know what I mean? But
motherfuckers do.
Yeah.
Motherfuckers do.
I get it. I get it. And it can be maddening. But that I say the limit, if you want me to fucking not be upset, it's 3.
3 is a good number, but I also think, well, sometimes people are a little less than forthright in text conversation. So I might even give them like a grace period of 5.
Okay.
If it's more than 5, fucking call me. There's a goddamn phone in your hand. There's a weird function on the goddamn thing that allows you to dial people up and, yo, what's up, man? And you have a
exactly.
conversation
like
for a couple of minutes that takes the place of it. It replaces like 20 or 30 fucking messages, right?
And the need to have to fucking have your phone right close to your ass at every given moment.
Now, there's an individual I've bitched about on this show, and I'm not going to fucking mention him by name this time because you fucking probably know who I'm talking about.
Well, if you do, your phone's going to ding.
No, I got the volume off. And he's been sectioned off from the rest of society for his own safety.
I love it.
No, I this is maybe the oldest friend I have. I always consider would be my nephew because fucking we were raised together like fucking brothers for a long time, you know. And
right.
shit, and that guy went in the Marines 1 year after I did. You know.
Wow. Okay.
And I went in for 5 instead of 6 like I did, and we got out about the same time. So,
huh? Yeah. Shit.
I mean, yeah. Now he's living in Missouri and shit, but he's the oldest friend I have. So there's that.
And that's a big batch.
Yeah,
you know?
It is. So when I say this other individual is, it's up. He's up there in tenure. He's up there with a couple of other people. He's not gonna. I've maintained friendships with a couple of dudes that I was in the Marines with.
Yeah.
So that shit's all from late 80s, early 90s.
Right.
And then along comes this bumbling motherfucker who shall not be named. But this opens up my fucking first day of fucking vacation with just a wall of nonsense. I mean, now here's the other thing, too, is that, if we're messaging and you're like, and we're actually having conversational shit, you better pick that motherfucking phone up and call it about message number 3 or 4. Because by 5, I'm going to start getting angry.
Well, exactly.
So this dude does nothing but send memes. Nothing but memes. And no, it's not like he's out there mining shit out of Russia that I haven't seen before. So he's usually sharing shit I've already seen a dozen times in the run-up to Christmas Eve. I eat my first day of vacation.
And it tends to lack the hilarity after about the 10th time.
Well, because he actually also has to editorialize.
Oh, good.
Look, here's this meme. I think it'd be funnier if it said this. And it's not. And it's not. Because his sense of humor is a little... His fucking compass is fucked. True North will find its way straight up his asshole instead of to the North Pole. That's his compass.
Every time he made jokes, I would always laugh, but in the most, like, I'm not laughing type of way.
You mean like the applause, like applause in golf, but translated over to laughing.
Yeah. Right? Yeah. It's like, and he'd get up real close. Like, I don't know why people like getting up on my shit and talking to me.
You got to start stiff arming. I would absolutely integrate that immediately because the same people that invade your space, you know why they don't invade mine? Because I've given them that before. I've given them like, nope.
I've seen you. I've seen Jack do it. Yeah. Just by my look, people wouldn't want to be around me.
No, you got to hand check them. You got to fucking absolutely deliver that stiff arm to let them know. There we go. Here's my inner circle. You're in my bubble now. Say what you must and then get the fuck out.
Because I feel like if I'm talking to you and I'm 2 feet in front of your face, I feel like I'm probably about to wear one. Because why else am I that close to you trying to talk to you?
It's going
to
be an interesting day, Tater.
Yeah, just be like, getting like, so what do you think about that football game last night, huh? Well, you don't have to be that close. You don't have to be.
No. No, we got an odd crowd that hangs around here. That's for fucking sure.
Yeah.
But the problem is the guy that's driving me fucking crazy isn't even a dude that hangs around here.
You would think he's here every fucking day.
Dude had a visit in November. But before that, you're going to go back almost 2 years.
Yeah. You consulted the cards, and the cards let you know that motherfucker was coming to town. That was weird.
No.
You've been predicting a lot of shit over the past 30. Ever since you got into this tarot reading, you've been oddly accurate about things outside of it.
It's all scythers.
Like 269.
Yeah.
UFC 269. You weren't specific as to what was going to happen.
No, I just knew something big was going to happen.
Yeah.
That's why we bought that one.
And you did. It happened multiple times, but for more than one reason.
Well, the Amanda Nunes, you know.
Okay, that was a big one.
Yeah. Yeah, and I knew nothing about Juliana Pena necessarily. I just knew there was something big. I felt the something big. I was afraid it was going to be fuck Charles Oliveira because I was rooting for that guy. But
yeah,
but I just knew there was going to be something that was going to change the UFC in a very profound way. And it turned out it was the Amanda Nunes
fight. You were not shitting, dude. I'm glad we picked it up. But yeah, it's going back to this guy. He's one of those people. Have you ever known someone in your life that if they suggest anything to you, recommend anything at all, be it music, TV shows, books, whatever, it could be a really great thing and you might actually really enjoy it, but you're going to stay the fuck away from it because they recommended it?
Yeah. No, absolutely.
Yeah.
This very same individual tried half a dozen times to get me to fucking get into Outlander. And I don't know. I don't even really know the premise of the show.
I mean, it's like in British times, right?
It's
pirates.
It's set in Scotland, right? I think.
Oh, I can already see why he was recommending it for you.
Because,
you know, you're Scottish, right?
Actually, it's weird. I'm an American. It's kind of bizarre. I think it is. I don't know. It's got a bunch of fucking Scottish actors in it. Actually, it has. Fiona McKenzie sings in it. And the reason why that one's important, her son went to UNM.
Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
She's basically been just merited with all these different orders of this and orders of this and orders of that over in Scotland and the UK in general for her ability to, I guess, basically do like really a lot of very old songs and bring them up to what normal standards should be.
Huh, that's a rare talent, yeah, right there.
And there's a lot of other interesting shit. But so yeah, that's one. That's a tie-in that I have, you know, because again, her son went to UNM. She's, you know, there in Scotland, living on my old Canna, you know. But
nice.
So there's that. But other than that, I mean, I used to drink scotch. I come from Scottish lineage, but other than that, it's not that big of a fucking
deal. And it's also not a selling point to why you would like to watch a fucking TV show either, right?
Well, and that's the other thing. If you start trying to muscle fuck me into having to watch a show, like, dude, you ought to watch this. I think you'll like it. And I've already told you no a couple of times. The answer is in, and the harder you try, the less I'm going to watch it. As a direct result, I will never watch Outlander.
Yeah, nor should you. You know,
I don't know. It might, like you'd said, it might be great, but I don't know.
I don't need any more friends in my life, and I don't need any more new TV shows.
Yeah, I don't mind the occasional, like, hey, man, have you checked this out? You might like it, maybe not. And then they lay it on me, I go, oh, I might check that out. But if you hit me with it like fucking four times before I've even had a chance to think about it, no, fuck you.
Yeah.
Fuck you.
I'm very much done. I mean, shit, I'm getting geared up to watch fucking Deadwood during birth week.
Yeah.
That's my bag.
Yeah, I was going through trying to think of all the pay TV shit. Because I'm not going to let that fucking price point creep, you know, sneak back in. Like, I used to pay, when I had satellite, when I got rid of it in 2015, my bill was $150 a month.
Fuck. Wow.
Now, there wasn't a lot that I couldn't watch.
Oh, sure. No, that you had all the options of the realm.
But the thing that occurred to me while I was silly was because I'd get home from work every day and throw on the same fucking station. And most of the time, that same station was on all the way till I went to bedtime. And I would watch about 10 minutes of TV. So it turned out I had to do some fucking, you know, some self-inventory, as they'd say, and figure out, wait a minute, why am I paying $150 a month for some shit when I rarely watch much of this, you know?
Yeah.
And it turns out it was just noise. It was just noise. And then once I started playing like a lot of the free TV shit, the cable cutters do or whatever, it did the same thing. It filled the same void. So guess what? I was basically just pissing away $150 a month.
But then you finally realized it. And once that internet got beefed up a little bit.
Well, and that gets us back to this problem. It's like, man, I don't want to see it because I'm already paying like $15 a month for the Disney bundle.
Right.
I'm paying $5 for the Peacock network for the good shits, which there are two on there now we need to watch. The Halloween one.
Right.
And Reno 911.
Oh, fuck. I forgot about their COVID one.
Yeah.
Oh, shit.
Now, that one also might be on Paramount Plus, which is okay because I'm also paying $5 for that. So my bill per month is $25. The thing that wrecks that is when we do a pay-per-view.
Yeah.
That immediately fucking makes my bill look ridiculous. But so for me to add HBO Max, that's $15 a month. So that basically is a bump of almost fucking doubling my cost.
Yeah, that Max, that's a big one.
So I think I'm going to get rid of the Disney bundle sans ESPN Plus because that's the only one out of that bundle I use. I burned through every bit of their Nat Geo shit on the Disney side of it. I'm done.
You don't want to watch Mandalorian over and over again?
Man, you know, we've talked about this. My problem is this, is that sci-fi doesn't work for me. But man, if one does, well, look out because that's going to be my favorite shit ever. But 99% of sci-fi, it falls flat with me.
Well, your standards for yourself are you know what you want.
Yeah.
There are a lot of people that just be like, I just want to go watch it and just have fun. I'm like, that's great. I need something in my sci-fi.
You got to make me care.
Yeah.
You know, that's the biggest problem I've got. The Expanse, people talk about, look at the amount of money they spent, the visuals, blah, 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 blah. Yeah, I know, but I don't give a fuck about any of these assholes I'm watching on TV.
Right.
None of them.
Yeah.
The fucking assholes on Earth are shitheads. The Belters are shitheads. The Martians are shitheads. They're all shitheads.
Well, that's what made Firefly great.
Firefly, you could get behind that crew.
The whole fucking crew. You were rooting for and, you know, fucking didn't want to see anything bad happen to them.
And I like things that are very raw and hard. And that's a little bit tough to pull off in a sci-fi world because, you know, your 1960s idea was, well, it's all these big chrome buildings and everyone, you know, basically.
Flying cars and the like.
Everyone can, you know, orgasm at will without using their hands. You know, that's the Roddenberry.
Damn, I want to live in that future.
Yeah,
I mean, of course,
cut scenes from Star Trek, right?
When TNG came out, I was like, you know, those holodecks. First thing I'm doing when I queue one up is I'm gonna go get me a woman. I'm glad in DS9 they actually like fucking Quark's place. Like, you can go fuck yourself a woman in a holosuite if you want.
Wow.
Well,
I didn't get that far into DS9. I guess I tried, but
well, the space station is in Bajoran territory.
Yeah,
so. It doesn't fall under the rules of Starfleet or any planet associated with it.
Okay.
Because even Bajor at the time isn't a part. They're trying to get into the Federation.
Yeah, because they'd been getting their ass kicked by the Cardassians.
Yeah, right? Yeah. To the point where they got DS9 back, because that's why it looks so gnarly. That's a Cardassian base.
Yeah, right.
Which kind of adds to the allure of it. But that's what made Quark so great. It was a fucking bar where you could go get laid. It was like the Gem Saloon. Fucking 500 years in the future.
He's getting ready to say, so he's kind of like fucking Al Swearingen just on a spaceship.
Right, and yeah. That motherfucker is running games, trying to make a buck on the background. Not entirely legal. Not really what you call a murderer or a goddamn road agent.
Was that fine gold-plated latinum? That's all
right.
You cared about?
That's right. That's one of my favorite fucking characters out of that one. Fucking Quark.
I should have given that one a better chance at a longer run. But
I can understand it being tough.
Seasons one and two makes that show really unapproachable.
Yeah. The awesome thing is, really, dude, you could jump into season three and you'll be fine.
Yeah, I get that feeling a little bit. Yeah.
Because that's really when, like, as soon as Cisco is able to shave his head and grow a goatee, that's when shit starts getting really good.
Okay.
Because it seemed like first two seasons of that, they were trying to make Avery Brooks, the guy that plays Cisco, this fucking soft guy.
Kind of got that feeling, right?
Yeah, but then...
Because he's going to be a Starbase commander, which is apparently like well below, you know, like the Kirks and shit like that,
right?
Running starships and shit, right?
Well, he was before he was on that. He was on a starship that was destroyed based on something that Picard had done. Because the very first episode,
they mentioned Picard in the first episode. Right.
Picard's in it. Him and Sisko have a conversation, and it's a pretty tense one. It's actually one. They open up with something that they can't keep up. You know what I mean? That moment is the highest moment. It happens like 30 minutes into the series.
Right.
So
as long as you watch the first, like, you know, 30 minutes of the series.
Then skip right to season three. You're good to go.
I don't know. That's the Star Trek universe is a weird one because you get the feeling like the world is only a good place because of the Federation, but the world is also a shitty place because of the Federation. It's that duality thing, right?
Right. Yeah. As you know, it's a. I don't know, man. Sorry, I'm trying to type and.
Oh, caught you multitasking.
I'm multitasking. It made my brain hurt.
Yeah.
So now I forgot what I was saying. Continue.
Yeah. No, really. But it's. Yeah, we can move on from the sci-fi thing. I think we're starting to kind of nerd out a little bit much for most people's taste.
I don't know, man. We are on the internet.
Yeah,
we are near.
Mead Metal MMA podcast. What we got going for the Mead side? Nothing really, because I have not bought honey.
I bought two bottles of Troublemaker.
Yeah, we're getting real low on stock. I need to get on and get another fucking fermenter because I've broken a couple of them because they get brittle over time.
Oh, yeah. Well, fuck. It's been 6 years into the game.
Yeah, yeah. Actually, probably if I was smart, and I'm not, I'd buy a couple of them.
Ew.
But yeah, we got to get a batch going. That was my intent, but man, the whack-ass holiday season around Walmart, that's a no-go for me.
Yeah, so. It's like going back to the days of ordering that shit through the mail, right?
Speaking of Walmart, have you noticed, so since the pandemic began, and I realized then at that point in time, a lot of people started, working from home, and a lot of people were without jobs and shit like that. The only place in town where motherfuckers could like kind of gather was a Walmart. All right. Fine. That's fine for March 2020. This is fucking December 2021. I go at 10 in the morning. That goddamn place is packed. The fucking does nobody have a job anymore?
Not during the Christmas holiday.
What are we, fucking like a bunch of lumberjacks or something?
I mean, shit, it is Christmas Eve. I got off work at 4 o'clock.
Well, I walked out yesterday like at 1, but actually that's a lie. I walked out at noon because I thought, let's get an hour jump on that vacation, huh?
Hey, man, that's a fucking extra hour of joy in life and something for other people to ruin for you.
As they do. As they do.
Not to return to the rage.
No. Man, I don't know. Maybe I am too nice of a fucking guy. Because I think your average person would go, man, I've had, that's enough. That's enough for today. I'll talk to you another time. But in this, I've got this weird part of me, though. It's like, I don't want to turn my phone off. That would fix everything.
Oh, fuck yeah. But damn right it would.
But I have this weird fucking thing of, like, there are some people I care about, and if there's something bad that happens, I want them to be able to connect with me and reach out.
Get yourself a landline again, bro.
No. Goddamn. Yeah, I might as well just get Dish Network back the fuck out here and get a landline going, pretend like it's 1998.
Go to Walmart, get you one of them straight talks. You can get like home phone service like $15 a month. And you can turn your phone off. Just be like, and you give that number to the people that fucking matter. So when you're done with your phone and you want a fucking break from existence, we can still get a hold of you.
Maybe, yeah. Maybe I'll just get another cell phone. Be like a drug dealer around here, right?
Oh, get so a burner. Like, get so a fucking like, burner
yeah,
phone.
That's right.
Yeah.
So I got the one for work, you know, that assholes have. And then I'll have another one just like the people I like have, you know.
Yeah. The one, the old Virgin Mobile.
Right.
I get behind that.
Metal side of it all, we don't have LJ this time around because he still has issues.
The poor man has issues, and we ain't talking the Korn album, folks. We're talking the technological lot of the size.
What, his laptop melted down again?
Laptop shit the bed again. Said he had one hammered out. His laptop shit the bed. I checked my email before 6 o'clock, hoping that maybe the issue got rectified. I'm assuming it did not because I got nothing.
Well, and it was going to be a little bit, because the order was going to be like, man, let me know your three favorite releases for 2021. And the argument would be, or the question would be, what do you mean releases? Do you mean songs? Do you mean albums? Do you mean artists? I would say, yes.
Just in general? Okay.
And I don't even know if I want to go that route, because then I'm prioritizing things, and fuck that.
Well,
but I will say my favorite release of the year was Jerry Cantrell's Brighton release.
Yeah. I agree that was a great album, but just to be contrarian to the fact, I'll go with Hushed and Grim. I feel like that was probably the best total release I heard all year.
Man, there's a track, and I was going to commit the name of it to memory, and I can't, but it's the one we play around here a lot. It's like the sixth track, I think.
On the Cantrell? Dismembered?
No, on Mastodon.
Oh, fuck. See,
which, by the way, and that was Brandon's pick, is Mastodon. He'd said the album name, but not the band. But.
Oh, yeah. Well, you cunts better recognize.
you better recognize.
If y'all don't know I'm talking about Mastodon, get the fuck out of here right now. let me pull that up.
Man, I don't remember. Now, Dismembered would be my favorite one off of Brighton.
Yeah, that one, it between that and Siren Song for me.
That one and Atone. Jerry Cantrell knows how to hit me the fucking right way, because they did the same thing with Alice in Chains. The songs they dropped before the rest of the record, the singles they dropped, are like my favorite tracks.
Yeah. It was a slow burn for me. Brighton was, because it came out of left field.
It's all major chords.
Like, God, what the fuck is this? And really not a whole lot of what you would call rock guitar.
Jerry's doing the same shit we're doing. Just try to fucking find a little glimpse of happiness somewhere, yeah?
Yeah, but then you're like, listen to that shit. It's like, wait, hold on. This is still some depressing shit. Although it seems like he pulls through in the end, you know? But I think between those two albums, those would be on my top three.
Yeah.
After that, I got to admit, that first night of the Metallica 40th anniversary concert was pretty fucking good.
How many concerts by Metallica have we caught this year now? That was the second one, I think. Maybe the third.
Yeah.
I don't know. And we didn't even catch the Sunday night, which has got to be somewhere on Prime, I would think, unless that was just a one-time fuck you.
They're, I believe, streaming it on demand.
Okay.
At this weekend.
That'll work. Yeah, because the first one, I was a little more stunned than anything, because I couldn't. I always try to figure out what a band is doing. I want to know what they're doing.
Right.
Tool, it's easy in their concert, because they were touring for Fear Inoculum, and they were able to work in other tracks from their older shit that made sense, you know, and they stitched it together really, really well.
Yeah.
Alice in Chains kind of did a similar thing. They kind of, they'd phase like some older stuff, and then they'd phase in their new stuff, and then phase in older. They were kind of back and forth on that. I was like, so what is Metallica's, what's the method of the madness here? And it took me halfway through the concert to actually figure it out, because I am, by the way, a little dumb.
And we were drunk.
Yeah, because they start with shit off that fucking first record of theirs.
Yeah.
Like, what?
They came out hot.
And I thought, well, they're clearly just playing the heaviest shit, which led me to believe then. And so my brain's already working in overdrive going, so is Sunday going to be they play the slower shit? And turns out, no, that had nothing to do with it. It was actually, they did a chronological approach.
Right.
Which I can appreciate, But nobody does it, so I immediately discounted that right away, going, well, they're clearly not running from oldest to newest, right? That's exactly what they did. Their entire fucking library.
Yeah, Hit the Lights, Creeping Death, Trapped Under Ice, and that's first two albums right there. Shortest Straw, hearing that was fucking really, really nice. The version of fucking, let's see, where did it go? Fucking Fixer, which has never been played live before. I think that's what, it's always cool that a band being around that long can still do shit. It's like, we ain't never done this before.
Right.
So let's do it.
Hey, everybody. All of us are sober. We might be able to pull this one off now.
They rocked their cover of Budgie's Bread Fan. Fucking No Leaf Clover hadn't been played in like 10 years or something.
Well, that was I think Jack brought it up around here. I was like, are they going to do Garage Band? Probably not, right? I'm like, yep, there it is, Garage Inc.
and it's one they wrote. I was thinking No Leaf Clover. Then they did Frantic, which I guess if you're going to do a song from Saint Anger, if you're doing songs from each album, you got to pick one.
Right.
I'm glad
it's like the All-Star game.
I'm glad they went with that and not the title track.
Right.
Title track starts out great.
Yeah, but the problem, and here's the thing, and I know it's going to hurt probably LJ's feelings, but Saint Anger is you and I note that is one of their worst records, right?
In the, okay, I'll modify it to make it sound less terrible.
Okay.
Saint Anger is at the bottom of the list of Metallica albums they put out.
Okay.
I don't want to say it's the worst because, I mean, well, it has its moments.
Then it does sound like you were absolutely trying to place it in a numbers scheme, and that's not helpful.
Yeah. In any list
I put in the same group as I do Load and Reload.
Oh, you fucking
and those are
bitch.
Records I don't like. So that's kind of where I'm at.
This podcast is over. We can't there be friends is. No more.
But it becomes as no surprise because you know I'm not a fan of those.
Oh, two. No. I went from defending Load and Reload for a lot of years to just being like, hey, man, some people don't like Catfish. They don't like the bluesy Metallica of the 90s.
Right.
I get it. I finally get it. But I'm also not the guy that's like, oh, bro, if you don't like Metallica, you're kind of a cunt to me.
Well, but it's also kind of weird because, so I went from like Load and Reload, and Reload's still a hard one for me, but Load has a few on there that you've played around here. It's like, you know what? I could get behind this.
Yeah. Like there's a few. I still,
because mentioning the bluesy side, I was like, I recall there was one in there. They're doing basically straight up fucking blues on that track in a very heavy way. And I thought, yeah. I can appreciate what they're doing on that.
Because both, basically, those fucking 28 songs were written all at the same time.
Right. It's just, I guess it didn't knock my socks off because, and that's what happens if you don't like Metallica and then suddenly the Black Album comes out and then you consider yourself to be a casual Metallica fan. That's what happens. And that's right. Exactly who I am.
Yeah. Yeah. But I think, I mean, shit, your involvement in Metallica related business just continues to grow. And that's fucking great, especially come from a point where it's like, hey, Metallica's not just, it ain't for me.
Right. Yeah. Death Magnetic kind of turned me around on that one.
Yeah. And they played That Was Just Your Life night one. That was fucking. Ooh. Damn.
Yeah. I forgot that Unforgiven 3 is on that one. I forgot about that entirely. Probably buried in my subconscious because it's not great.
It's not a bad song, but it's just so like, really? Unforgiven 3?
Well, Rush did them in threes. We got to do them in threes.
At least on Unforgiven 2, in the song, I mean, on the album, it's called Unforgiven 2.
Right.
But in the song, it's T-O-O.
Right.
You're Unforgiven 2. That. So, goddamn, they could have called that fucking song anything else.
Anything, right.
Anything else. But they had to go, like, we're writing a sequel, bitches.
Right. It's like, you're getting the third installment. All Things Must Have Threes trilogy.
That is a trilogy.
Right.
It's a fucking trilogy.
Spread over different records, and that's exactly what Rush did with their Fear.
Right. You know. Dream Theater did the same thing. It's called the 12-step suite that Portnoy kind of had, where you will hear riffs from, like a song from one of the previous albums, a riff that leads into a new song, but it's the same riff going in on a new album. And it, I forget the list of the songs because goddamn Dream Theater songs are like TV shows.
They are, yeah.
But it was really cool because you'll hear them like, goddamn, that sounds so familiar. It's like, yeah, because you heard it from a Dream Theater album like 5 years ago. But it's a little too on the head to call it like Unforgiven. Unforgiven 2. What are we going to call the next one? Fuck it. Let's just call it Unforgiven 3, right?
Yeah.
and it's a little, they went a little too fucking experimental on it, I think. A lot of horns.
Right.
I like the piano at the beginning.
I think it's, yeah. The piano's actually, I appreciate where it's at until, damn it, it's that one song, it begins, it sounds like a ballroom fucking, you know, that yeah. begins the whole fucking thing. It's like, fuck you, you're Metallica. I know what you're trying to do. Right.
Yeah. I have looked at Night 2, you know.
Okay. See, this is the one we haven't seen. Because it was on a Sunday night, that thing started 10 p.m. local time.
And yeah.
Some of us got jobs, bitches.
Some of us had to work. So they open up with Hardwired.
Okay.
Good opener.
That's like, man, out of all their entire library, and they're trying to play something new and relevant, that's the perfect song.
Which, by the way, the end of Night 1 was Spit Out the Bone. So yeah. Start of Night 2 being Hardwired, that's a good continuation, in my opinion.
Right.
Opened up End of the Line off Death Magnetic. They haven't played that fucking song live in 11 years. Woo.
Are they working backwards on the second night?
No, this is...
Okay.
Actually, you know what? Hold on.
So they did a stairway up and then a stairway back?
Yes, they did.
Well, there
yes,
you go.
Yes, they fucking did.
All right.
Oh, my God.
Okay. That was just a guess.
Yeah, look at it. Holy shit. So we got... The next one is the Saint Anger track. They... Chose Dirty Window. Dirty Window's okay.
Yep.
It's okay. I Disappear from the fucking Mission Impossible 2 soundtrack. They haven't played that live since August of 2013. Going back to Garage Inc., they rocked Am I Evil. Haven't played that in 10 years. And then we get two from Reload, Memory Remains and Fuel, which are, those are the two you're going to play off Reload.
Yep, you bet. Yep.
I really like this. They played Bleeding Me and Wasting My Hate off of fucking Load. And those are like my two favorite fucking songs off of Load, dude.
Same here, but that's because those are your fucking favorite
yeah.
songs.
They're the ones I always play.
Right, right. Yep.
So they're ones you're familiar with.
Yeah, right. Yeah, exactly.
After that, the token Black Album tracks of Unforgiven and Sandman, of course. Harvester of Sorrow, Harvester. Master of Puppets, Fade to Black, Whiplash, Seek and Destroy. Thank you, fuck you, good night. No encore.
So they close with all the hits, but they do work backwards.
Shit, I think Bleeding Me and Wasting My Hate are not the hits off of Load. Fucking Ain't My Bitch, Until It Sleeps, King Nothing. They did not play King. No, they did on Night 1. Yeah, they did. But that they played that off of Load, and Night Number 2, they fucking went heavy on Load and Reload. They got four songs total out of that fucking block. It's good to see those two albums getting represented on an anniversary.
Right.
And again, Bleeding Me, Waste My Hate. Both of them have been played since December 7th of 2011.
Well, if those are on video on demand, we'll be catching that shit.
We'll
I know what we'll be doing for Crimbus Day.
What you doing on Crimbus Day? Oh, and by the way, since we're still in the music aspect, I just got to say, Jack got me a kick-ass pair of fucking headphones for Christmas. I'm wearing them right now.
Along with the panties he got you right?
Well, you know, the ones that have the little vibrating pod in them. He can work them while it's on vacation in fuck-offity land. But they are amazing. It almost makes me hate them because I can really hear us now.
Yeah, no.
I've kind of been rocking one ear for...
Ever.
So this is the first podcast where I actually really am engrossed in both my voice and Kevin's. And it's, you know, it's different.
Well, the thing is because you would always get my cast off.
Right.
The shit from my job is like, hey, bro, here you go. It's only got one ear that works. But because, yeah. I mean, because if you're getting them, there's a reason they're getting retired. And that's because they ain't doing what they're supposed to do anymore.
These motherfuckers do exactly what they're supposed to do. You should hear porn in these things.
Hard pass. Yeah. Sounds like you'd hear suction, right?
You hear a lot more than that. I was watching one the other day, and I swear I heard a girl fart. I don't know what hole it came out of, but I heard an expulsion of air. Might have been Chipotle. It might have been just...
Clearly wasn't getting finger cuffed, huh?
I was just about to go on a weird tangent. I think I'm going to pull it back.
All right. Good man. Good man. Always pull
back. Is that the right thing to do?
Right. Shit. MMA. Now, granted, keep in mind, too, is that we don't need to do a year-end definitive list of any fucking thing because we're doing another one for your birthday next week.
Hell yeah.
But anything out of the UFC that kind of rises a little bit that maybe is something that we can cover it this week and that therefore we can put it behind us for next week.
I'm hoping Khamzat fucking really gets some work done this year or next year.
Yeah, he what the fuck happened? He called out. No, he got called out. Bilal Muhammad.
Oh.
Which sounds like a fucking terrible idea to me.
Yeah, but see, the thing is, Bilal's a wrestler. Khamzat's a fucking wrestler, too. And he's one of those wrestlers that's like, I'm going to take you down first, and I'm going to keep you there. That's what he fucking does all the time. Every fight starts, punch, takedown. And it works. I'm going to drag you to my fucking corner, and I'm going to blast you. Granted, the Mearshart fight didn't get to go that far because
that right hand didn't get to go
to the takedown. Yep. Landed. I got to get another beer.
Gotcha. Well, so. I'm good. So that's the funny thing. So nobody calls out Khamzat. Matter of fact, people fucking try to figure out reasons to not have to fight him.
Leon Edwards real good at it.
Very good fighters. Very good fighters. Like, no, I don't want to fight that guy. Are you crazy? Like, I'm on my way to the championship. I don't want to have to fight this punk.
What do you want me to do? Lose? I'm going to lose here.
but yeah, that's kind of interesting. That's the first time I recall somebody called him out. And I like Bilal Muhammad, but damn it, I don't think he has the skills to fight a fucking crazy chaos motherfucker like that guy.
I thought, man, this dude just fight. He initially fought back-to-back weeks, like just active as a motherfucker. I thought maybe that inactivity would
Retire because of that COVID shit, right?
Well, because he tried to train for a fight while having COVID.
And it scared him.
Well, it's good. It's good to know that he has fear for life-threatening events, not for fighting chumps,
right?
Because I do. I'm sure that dude's
for that guy,
right?
Everybody's a chump.
Yeah. Fuck yeah, God, dude. It's a.
I mean, the thing is, by the time though, that division is so deep. By the time that anybody gets to, you know, Kamaru's going to actually be probably getting up there in age.
Kamaru probably won't be champ by that time.
Yeah, like, you know, it's time for another new blood always moves in.
Yeah, and whoever is unlucky enough to beat Usman for the belt is probably getting Chimaev next right after that.
Yeah. Man, and let's not forget that if you're on the path and you're going forward, fuck, there's a dude by the name of Colby Covington who, frankly, could have won that championship twice now.
He can beat everybody except Kamaru Usman. We've talked shit a lot about how this guy has played the game. He has fucking built that Trump character and rolled with it 100%. Now, it does seem like maybe he's throttled that back just a little bit. Probably so, because I kind of hate him a little less. It was still nice to see Usman knock him out. Or not knock him out, but fucking dominate him for 5 minutes. Five rounds. Fuck's sake. Had too much beer to drink. But bottom line is, Colby's striking is really what he's known for. Dude's a wrestler, but known for his striking. There are a lot of fighters in the UFC that hold on to that mantra. Justin Gaethje being one. I'll get to that motherfucker in a minute. But at the end of the day, if Kamaru loses that belt in a fashion where he doesn't get a rematch immediately, Colby's probably in a spot where he's going to get that shot.
I think that's why he's hanging around with the top. Well, first of all, the guy's fought to be where he is. It's unfortunate for him in his mind that he's not sitting at the very top of the C next to his name, but instead of he's got the one.
He's been given two opportunities.
But he has. He's going to have to do something.
Given was a bad word.
Bad fucking news for somebody in the top five.
Yeah.
Because Colby Covington is as much of a goofball as he is. The dude is legit.
What do you think about Bilal Muhammad and Colby?
That'd be the fight to make, I think.
Yeah, right?
Man, if Bilal's want to call out a dude below him and fucking and Chimaev,
and then you give one
go ahead, but you're letting the fucking dogs in the house.
And then you give Khamzat fucking Wonder Boy.
That's who the fuck wants to fight that guy?
I hopefully some Neil Magny is like I want that fight with him to happen that was initially announced. But Neil Magny is kind of an old warrior. I mean, that's just his mentality. He don't give a fuck,
right?
Until maybe he's wearing some fucking leather via Khamzat.
They need to get back to Fight Island because that's the only way the Khamzat's going to be able to fucking...
I thought he was here now. I thought he's in the States.
Was he?
I can't recall. Because after, if he's not fighting, I'm kind of not following his shit.
Yeah.
I got to be honest.
His stuff is fucking nonsense.
Dude gets a fight announced, I'm paying attention to what he's up to.
Yeah. I don't think so. I think that dude's in Russia or Sweden, one of the two, because he claims Sweden, but apparently he's born and raised in Russia.
What a confused child. I shouldn't have said that. He's going to come find me.
Yeah.
there's actually, you know what? I'm going to save the Justin Gaethje lightweight title picture fucking screaming match I want to have with Dana White for next week.
Good. So maybe actually
that's bullshit. See, I had to let a little bit out.
I'm going to have to probably do a little research because I don't think I'm in the know of what you're going on about. So
apparently everybody that has the ability to make fights are wanting fucking Charles Oliveira and Conor McGregor to fight for the belt in May.
Right. Yeah.
Exactly. Yeah. Like, you can lose two fights in a row, be the highest... I don't even know how.
Why don't they just name Conor McGregor as like some kind of a chairman of something? So that way it's justified. It's like, yeah, sorry, man. What do the people way up in our organization want to step in and play?
Sometimes you got to fight your boss, bro. But it doesn't make any sense to me. Conor McGregor doesn't have to fight for a belt to make money.
That's what the promotion knows. That's
why
he dropped everybody.
Two in a row. Actually, fuck.
It doesn't matter. That's why everybody calls out Conor McGregor. I feel like post fights, like, who do you want next? And if you're at 155 to 170, you're clearly going, well, Conor. But beyond that, it's this guy, that guy, whatever. Because everybody knows you're going to get paid. If you fight Conor McGregor, you're going to get paid.
I will go ahead and say this. My MVP of 2021. Is going to be Derek Lewis.
Oh, wow.
Just overall entertainment factor. I fucking love this man. He is enjoyable. He's hilarious. He's violent.
Yeah.
And is blunt as a motherfucker.
Oh, yeah. You bet.
If you can be blunt and entertaining all at the same time, that is a rare package to have.
Did I tell you about the shit that happened to him a couple of days after the event?
When he got pulled over by a cop.
Right, right.
I saw the video for that.
Yeah,
he's 2-0 against cops.
Right. Yep. 2-0 against cops.
Ain't no one stopping their feet in line to match for that one. Oh, yeah.
But mine for 2021 would be Rose Namajunas.
Yeah, you want to talk about fucking someone coming back to where... Like exactly where they were when she won that belt the first time.
I have yet to feel that she's reached her fucking plateau of where her expertise is at.
You think Carla Esparza is the one to show her flaws in her game?
Here's the problem is I don't think that Carla's game's any better than it was when she beat Rose.
No.
And Rose's game is exponentially better. I think Carla Esparza gets fucking exposed in a big way if they make that fight. And Rose wants that fight.
Sure. Well, really, Carla Esparza has won like three or four in a row. They have history. I mean, shit, Carla beat her fucking many, many, many moons ago.
A long time ago.
Carla Esparza is a little different. Fucking Rose Namajunas is fucking unrecognizable.
Yeah.
compared to that fighter.
That's right.
It doesn't end well. I mean, she's turning into 115 Shevchenko.
Yeah.
Only she does it with her hands. Shevchenko does it with her whole body. Believe me, I know. Hey, ooh.
Shevchenko's Instagram account is worth a follow, by the way.
Yes. Get a whole bunch of fine wallpapers for your phone.
There's one. She's got like a whole bushel of goddamn roses. Like, here she comes, Brandon. She's going to make take her last name. And
Brandon Shevchenko? You bet your ass. What, Valentina Barajas? No, I don't think so. I'll be I will be Mr. Valentina Shevchenko Barajas.
Mr. Valentina.
Mr. Valentina. God, that sounds awesome.
That's a weird shit. When I was a child, way back in those days, when that shit was acceptable, I'd go grab mail out of the mailbox, and it was always addressed to Mr. and Mrs. Leif D. Robbins. I was like, my mama's name ain't Leif. What the hell? What is this shit? I was like, because back then, that's it. You got the man. And you throw his wife in, too, to make her feel a little special. But it's the Mr. and Mrs. and the guy's name.
Huh. Now it's just like the household.
You do that shit nowadays. It's like you're either an octogenarian or you're a right cunt.
You are a violent, violent man. Oh, man. Well, shit. What do you want to do now?
I want to drink more liquor. Probably me too. Crank up some fucking tunes, probably.
Ooh, on the Strymon?
I'll mention that real quick.
Today's episode.
Had our gift exchange last week ago today.
# headphones.
And I knew you guys were doing something fucking ridiculous, so. But, it was a Strymon pedal, which is only fucking nonsense, because those things are usually anywhere between $300 to $600, so.
Suck a lot of dick, dude. Fucking get that for you, guy.
They're like a service seal on the street corner.
Still picking ejaculate from between my teeth.
The night sky reverberator. You can find the perfect reverb that you want and save it as a preset.
It's like a reverb sandbox.
It is. It really is.
I've tinkered with it a couple times, and I feel like I don't know nothing about it.
It's a weird one too. I mean, because very small movements, you know, on the dials, like utterly change things in a very profound manner.
Yeah, very noticeable.
So, but that was a sweet little gift. And man, I've been wanting to get in some Strymon pedals. It's just I didn't realize that'd be where I would start, but. That's a hell of a start. That's a hell of a start. So
yeah, not a bad Christmas.
I'm gonna have to do like Daryl and start working on a second fucking pedal board altogether.
You're gonna need like a 3-story motherfucker.
I'm gonna have a Strymon board and I'm gonna have a board for everything else. So
hey, oh shit. All right.
Go straight MIDI and
damn.
Yeah.
That's the next barrier, right?
Yeah. Actually, that's the problem. This shit's all down the road. Like, so provided like I win the lottery or hit a couple banks. Whatever, you know, but that's a lot of money. Because actually, ahead of that, we need to get a new DAW, and we need to get a new studio suite. So we're going to go Bitwig, I think,
DKV. From what I've seen, it seems to be pretty straightforward as far as operation.
Yeah. So we've got some priorities around here. And at some point, this will be an EDM lounge, damn it. Some point. It will. Someday.
Hey, that's Strymon. It's getting close to doing it.
I could start just filling in. I don't even.
All we need is a drum machine. Really, we're good to go.
All right. Well, that's it for this week, you heathens. We're going to be back next week because it's this heathen's birthday. We'll be celebrating that one.
Yeah, we're going to be doing the podcast about 11:30 p.m. Wrap it up around 12:30.
I don't know about that. Maybe. We could. We could.
I don't know
if you'd want that.
I don't know if I'd want that recorded and put on the internet for all time.
Yeah, there's that. Right?
We'll get it done normal time.
Man, hope you have a great Christmas, and we'll be right fucking back at it again for the final show of 2021 coming up next week. Mead Metal MMA Podcast. Tell your friends. Tell your family. Hide your wives. Hide your children.
Because they're raping everybody up in here.
Because somebody. I don't know. Something like that.
Because everybody's somebody.
All right. Merry fucking Christmas, huh? Merry fucking Christmas.